HIMT, Hindustan Institute of Maritime Training.
Which pump is that? Centrifugal. Emergency valve. So why we are using, you know, what is the advantages of centrifugal? Suppose if you say that we are going to talk about centrifugal pump. So let's talk all about centrifugal pump. So first thing is advantages. Advantage. What are the advantages? Why do we use centrifugal pumps more? So centrifugal pump, what is the key said? Flow rate. That means what large volumes can be handled in a centrifugal pump. Like for example, any of you from oil tankers like VLCC? Very large crude oil carrier. Any of you? Nobody? Product tankers? Okay, can you tell me the capacity of your pump, centrifugal pump? Cargo pump?
3000
cubic meter per hour. Now what's the tonnage of the ship?
75,000.
So 3000 cubic meter. Suppose a VLCC, you will find somewhere around 5000 to 6000 cubic meter. So 6000 cubic meter per hour, let's say 3 pumps are running. Now, then in 1 hour, how much of cargo discharge you will be able to do? 6000 multiplied by 3, 18000 cubic meters. 18000 cubic meter goes in 1 hour. In 10 hours, 180,000 tons. In 10 hours. In 20 hours, what's the capacity of your ship? VLCC, somewhere around 300,000. But your capacity is 360. That means very comfortable within at least 20, if not 20, 24 hours, you will be able to discharge the entire. You see, that's a big advantage. Large volumes can be handled by centrifugal pump. That is the biggest advantage. So you will use onboard the ship, many places we use. Your main seawater pumps, jacket pulling seawater pumps, many in lubile pumps. You know, these are all the types of pumps. Apart from that, you have what about your ballast pump? What about your fire and GS pump? Isn't it? General service pump or fire pump. Everywhere we are using centrifugal pump. So how does the centrifugal pump work? What is the basic concept? Now here we are, when we talk about advantage, you said large volume. Correct? Okay, large volume, this is the main advantage. Any disadvantage? What is the disadvantage? Framing required. Correct. Framing required means what? The vessel, the pump cannot handle vapor or air or vapor. So it can handle only liquid. Can handle water, or it can handle oil, any liquid it can handle, but it cannot handle air, it cannot handle vapor, any vapor. Why? What is the reason? Because sometimes you will find questions there, they are asking when your air blower can handle large volumes of air, you know, there we don't need much pressure. What we need, air should go to your, that's your scavenger, isn't it? You see your turbocharger, I am talking about blower side. Your blower, this blower, what does it do? It takes air from atmosphere through a filter and supplies air to the engine, that's your scavenger. There it performs. Where it handles. So if you are looking at, basically on one side you have blower, then you have pump, then you have compressor. Isn't it? Your blower, vapor or gas, or you can say gas, blower, air blower. What about your engine room blowers? You have blowers, no? The engine supplying air to the engine. It can be an exhaust blower, or on board an oil tanker you may have, in the pump room you have a blower, you call it exhaust blower. So blower means what? It handles air or gas, you can say. And pump, only liquid. Compressor? Compressor again? Air. Compressor doesn't handle liquid, does it?
No, sir.
Compressor means only air. But then this, look at the pressure, what compressor develops. And what you, in as far as blower is concerned, then what you need to understand is it handles large volume of air. Large volume of air is required at a lower pressure. Pressure is not the main criteria there. Yes, pressure is there, but then a large volume flow, that's what is required for your engine room blowers. You know? Whereas compressor, your main air compressor, see the pressure range. It must be able to fill up your air bottles. Air bottles are 30 bar. Up to 30 bar, no? You'll be able to fill up. So, high pressure. So, when you are talking about the disadvantage of a centrifugal pump, we are talking about priming required, isn't it? Priming required. Why priming is required? Because the pump casing and the entire pump casing needs to be filled with the liquid. Then only the pump can work. What is the reason? When it can handle liquid, why a centrifugal pump cannot handle air? What do you think? NPSH, no, let's not talk about it. Then we'll talk about it a little later. Let's go from the basics, fundamentals. Why centrifugal pump cannot handle air? Think about it. What do you think is the reason?
Revolution of the impeller should be more.
So, when you say, again, let's just basically look at that concept. Now, let us say this is your centrifugal pump impeller. Now, centrifugal pump impeller is like this. And you have something like this. What do you call this?
Volume casing.
Volume casing. So, this is your impeller. Now, if you just look at this, the impeller is going to be something like this. Now, the liquid enters here and goes out, correct? So, you can say this is the eye of the impeller. Okay, the liquid enters and then it comes out. But when liquid comes here, then what happens? It applies some sort of a some force there where the direction changes. So what does it do? It gives out some axial thrust. So you need to take care of the thrust by providing a thrust bearing. Any centrifugal. The liquid enters like this and then turns. Okay, so there is going to be some sort of a thrust. So you need to have a bearing. Thrust bearing. Then it comes out. So here what happened, these are all, what do you call this? These are all? Eye of the impeller, gain vanes, isn't it? And here we call it, what do we call it? Shrouded. Shrouded means what? Shrouded means closed. Closed, no? You see the impeller and compare it with the turbocharger blower. Have you seen the turbocharger blower? Is it shrouded? It's open. Whereas here it is closed. That's why they call it shrouded. Okay. So, what is happening? The liquid enters here. It comes out at the periphery. Then it keeps going like this. So, when a pump is like this, the pump can draw water from here and discharge. This is one way. Now, this is the eye of the impeller. Now, this is your pump. This is the eye of the impeller. Now, what do we call this? Now, the water level is below the pump. So, what is it called? This is called suction lift. Negative suction lift. Or, you may have liquid somewhere here. And you may have like this. You have opened this valve. So, from this to this, what is this called? Suction head, suction lift. Lift, the pump has to lift the water up. Okay, now how much is the suction in a, normally a centrifugal pump? it develops under pressure here at the eye of the impeller. Now what is the pressure you have? Atmospheric pressure. Here atmospheric pressure, no? When it is under pressure here, the pressure is low. Here pressure is high. Then what will happen? Atmospheric pressure being higher will push the water. So then what will happen? Water will go. Once the water reaches here, with the centrifugal pump will push it up. So to what level it pushes up, it depends upon the capacity of the pump. Like for example, you take 14 is where it will. Suppose if you have a pump at the ground level, to what level the pump can, one single pump, will it be able to carry, take the water all the way to the 14th floor, overhead tank? It depends upon the capacity of the pump. If the pump is designed, then it's different. Otherwise, normally, it may not be able to. So accordingly, you have to design a pump to take it all the way. So you have suction head, you have delivery head, you know, discharge head, suction head, suction lift. So when there is a suction lift, what can be the maximum suction lift here for a centrifugal? So this is the atmospheric pressure. Atmospheric pressure is the one which is going to push down, giving a, because of under pressure, this is going to reach. So how much is atmospheric pressure? One atmospheric pressure is equal to 1.02. That is, you can say so much of bar, 1.03 bar. But then if you make it 10 point something, so round figure you take 10 meters. So the maximum lift effectively a centrifugal pump can handle is 10 meters. This is theoretical. But in this pipe, suction pipe, definitely there will be some losses. Isn't it? So because of the losses, it is not going to be 10 meter. So it is going to be less than 10 meter. So somebody, how much it is?
7 meter.
7 meter, or effectively they say 6.7 meter. Around 7 meter, okay. So only 6.7, because there is going to be some losses, suction losses. So suppose if it is going to be more than this, then the pump will struggle. But as far as your suction head is concerned, it's not a problem at all. The moment you open the valve, then what will happen? Water will automatically come and fill up this. Water will fill up this, and water will come right up to this. That means what? Proper priming has taken place. Yeah, so even at home, what do? At home, when you have a problem, you have a centrifugal pump again, you have a pump for your at home to take up the water from the well or from the sump to the overhead tank, you have a pump. And you must have seen, when plumber comes, whenever any major job is done, what does he do? Always he fills up with water. On the pump you will see a plug, so he fills up. And have you noticed one more thing? On the inlet side, where it leads into the well or into the sump, right at the bottom there is a valve. He calls it foot valve. So it is a non-return valve. That means water will flow in, but it will not allow any water. If that foot valve is leaking, then what will happen when you stop the pump? Slowly the water column on the suction side will drain. If this water entirely drains, then when you restart this pump, there is the air here. Or there may not be water. So that means the priming is lost. So the pump will not exert. So again, what you have to do? Again, open up somewhere and add water. So this foot valve business, always you need to look at, in case when required you need to change. This I am talking about from the domestic front, just for you to have an idea. So now you take your pump. So what is happening here? The pump is rotating. The liquid is drawn here because of the pressure difference. And lot of energy is added, you know, because the velocity energy, because your impeller is rotating. A lot of energy is added and it comes out here, and then what is happening? The liquid flows. But have you seen what is the meaning of volute casing? Now see this. If you take this volume or this volume or this volume, do you see a difference?
Yes.
What is the difference? That means it slowly keeps on increasing. Why? See, you can compare this, like for example, we all have on board ejectors or adapters. You have seen?
Yes, sir.
Where all we use reductors?
Deballasting.
Deballasting in your line, you have a reductor. And in a tanker, we have for stripping, you know. So while discharging, you have a stripping. For stripping, you have an inductor. And where else? What about your freshwater generator?
Freshwater.
You are having air ejector. You have a brain ejector. You have, no?
Yes, sir.
Brain ejector and air ejector in your freshwater generator. What about pumping out chain locker bridges? You see? In, you have a chain locker, no?
Yes, sir.
Chain locker. Always anchoring, dropping anchor, taking up anchor. Your chain locker will have mud and water sometimes. That is the reason they ask for deck water whenever they are, you know, giving up anchor. You give deck water, no? The pressure. So your chain is washed. At least the mud part of it will go, but then water gets collected there. So how do you pump out? You use an ejector there. Isn't it? In many places you are using ejector. So what is the basic concept of ejector? See, let us say you have an ejector. It is something like this. Let us say this diameter is D. The pipe diameter is D. This is what we call convergent part.
Divergent.
Convergent and divergent. Now this particular point, what do you call? Throat. Or you can call it venturi. Basic concept is what? Venturi. So the liquid is flowing at a pressure of P with the velocity V. Okay, now at that throat, it is, let us call it, pressure is now P1, velocity is V1. And again, when the pressure, when it comes in the divergent part, when it comes here, here pressure is P, again velocity is V. So what has happened? P to P1, P1 to P. Now tell me, what is the relationship between P and P1? Is it this way, or is it this way, or is it this way? P is it more than P1, or equal to, or less than P1? All of you agree? Is it clear? So, P is more than P1. So, what is true? Now, this is true. Or you can say P1 is less than P. So now what happened? How does it? It helps us. Like for example, you have it in a tank. I'm talking about a tanker. You have one very little liquid. Okay, whereas in another tank you have lot of liquid. So your COP, your cargo oil pump, is taking suction from that pump and effectively discharging oil here. Now this is going to the manifold. You know, whatever cargo that you are discharging to the shore, one line is given and given at this, at a pressure of, let us say, about 7 bar, 6 bar. At that pressure, 6 bar pressure or 8 bar pressure, when the liquid is flowing, because otherwise it is going to the manifold to discharge. I am talking about your main COP is running all right. It is taking suction from one tank where the oil level is more. Okay, now one branch is taken here and it is going like this. Okay, now what happens here, there is some under pressure. Now this tank, you have very little oil. So the moment you have, let us say you have a valve here, when you open this valve, what will happen?
It will take
suction. Because of this under pressure, when the moment when this valve is open, because of low pressure, this oil will be sucked inside. And this tank will get empty. We are using it practically on tankers. We have seen people from tankers. We are using it for stripping purposes. The last part of the cargo. But is there any moving part? Anything rotating?
No.
Biggest advantage. You don't need. There is no moving part. So, this stripping can be done. Whereas the oil that is coming here is from some other tank where you have level of cargo is more, level of oil is more. So, always at the, now the point is,
From here to here, in the divergent part, again the pressure slowly rising, and then here it is normal pressure. Like this V and this D and this V, all are same. Or in other words, what you can do, from here to here, what is happening? This volume keeps on increasing. When you, this keeps on increasing, then what actually happens? The pressure is slowly building up and velocity is slowly reducing, or again conversion is taking place. Now from here to here, whenever increase in the two dimensional, you can call it area, otherwise basically it is volume. Now this is what is happening here. Now what is happening in the centrifugal form? When you look at this section here, here is more, this is something similar to this, is it not? So what is going to happen? That means with the increase in volume of flow, so the kinetic energy or the velocity energy is slowly getting converted into pressure energy, so that by the time the P, the pressure comes here, this gets built up. This is the basic concept of centrifugal form. But then this impeller, in which direction it should rotate? Clockwise or anti-clockwise?
Depending upon the wind.
Is it like this or it should break? Clockwise or anti-clockwise? Now see, you are looking at this. Now I have put the gateway in like this. Now tell me.
Clockwise.
Now you said depending upon what is that?
Blade angle should be opposite.
That's all ifs and buts. Now, as per this diagram, you tell me. As per this, I have given the gateway an angle like this.
Yes.
Now, your answer is, if it is like this, then it is other way. You know, that is confusion. Let us just see. As of this diagram, it is going to be like this. Have you understood, all of you? This is a basic concept of your centrifugal pump. So, again, now coming to, why centrifugal pump is not able to handle air? Basically, here, how the liquid is thrown to the periphery? Radially, no. Okay, the gateway helps you. From here to here, it is radially, it is thrown to the outermost. How is it happening? It is happening due to centrifugal force. Centrifugal force is throwing. What is centrifugal force? It's nothing. You just take a string, tie a stone at the end, then do rotate like this. I think you have studied it in school. So what happens? Depending upon your RPM, the stone is here. It is tied to the end of a string. Or if you do it very slowly, it is here. When you increase the RPM, it goes here like this. Correct? That is what is your centrifugal force. So now coming back, what is the centrifugal force? Let us say centrifugal force. Centrifugal force is the basics, if you see, M omega squared R. Do you recollect? You have studied this in school. Do you recollect or not? Looks like you are shocked. You are sitting like this. You don't remember this? Ashik? What is centrifugal force? Sir, in physics I studied long time, sir. After that I have done. See, anything basics you cannot forget. If I say 2 plus 2, remain same, no? So what is centrifugal force? Why do you call it centrifugal pump? Centrifugal pump because the actual pump flow, the rate of flow, everything is happening, the basic concept, the bottom line is centrifugal force. That is why we call it centrifugal pump. So what is centrifugal force? What is the formula for centrifugal force? M omega squared R. What is M?
Mass.
What is omega?
Angular velocity.
Angular velocity in this case proportional to the RPM of the pump. Yes or no? Pump revolution, RPM. And what is R?
Radius.
Okay, now suppose let us assume this pump is running at 1400 RPM. That means you fix up the RPM, 1400 RPM. So the pump runs at 1400 RPM constantly. You are not increasing the RPM. So now coming back to this formula, now the radius is same. So you can say it is a constant. Now RPM is same. I told you 1400. We are not going to change it. That means your R and omega squared becomes a constant. So then what you can say? Centrifugal force is proportional, directly proportional to
mass.
M, mass. Okay, now coming back to my question, why centrifugal pump cannot handle vapor or air? Now tell me, how would you compare the density of air with density of water? Where it is more dense, which fluid mass is more?
Water.
Or oil or anything, any liquid, the mass is more. Whereas if you say air or any vapor, it is not denser. So mass wise, it will be, suppose if at this 1400 RPM, if liquid enters, water enters, it is thrown here, so this, it continues, it performs. Whereas if air enters here, since the centrifugal force is going to be so less, it may not be able to reach here, it is trapped here. At this RPM, same RPM. Now the only differential point there is only the mass. So compared to if it is water or if it is oil or if any liquid, it is thrown here to the periphery, into the casing, volume casing. Suppose if it is going to be any gas or vapor, it is centrifugal force is going to be so low, it is now here. Now, unless otherwise this moves here, nothing will come from the inlet pipe, isn't it? Only when it is displaced here, then something will come from the inlet pipe. But this is not moving, it is not trapped. It is there. That means there is not, it just interrupts the flow. That means what do we call it? The pump has lost suction. Or in the engine room, very often we use the common term airlock. We use the term, no? Like for example, your emergency fire pump is running. Everything seems to be alright. But the pressure, it's not building up any pressure. If you open any of the fire hydrant, no water is coming. Practically it happens, no? Have you seen it is happening? So then what you need to do? Bring the water in. Expel the air. That means your emergency fire pump, what sort of arrangement we have? You always have a priming unit. How does this priming unit work? Because always when you start the pump, you see, in the... So have you understood this concept? So let me rub it out. So you have something like this. This is rotating, this is rotating. Isn't it? Initially, when the emergency fire pump, when you start the emergency fire pump, it is always engaged. Correct? So then what happens? That means the priming unit is working. Priming unit is priming. It is sucking the air from the inlet pipe of the pump. But once the air is drawn, when water starts coming, then what is happening? The pump is taking suction, the pump will discharge side, the pressure will build up. Now, from there, what will happen is, so it needs to get disengaged. How this disengagement is done? So you have a cylinder and you have a piston and you have something like this. So then what will happen? Whatever from the discharge side of the pump, when the pump takes suction from the discharge pipe, there is a small pipeline connection to this. Now this is your piston. So that reaches, so this gives a push. Because when there is a pressure water here, then what? This piston is, that means it gets an axial movement disengaging it. That's what is happening, you know? That is automatically every time when you start the emergency fire pump, it is engaged. And once the pump takes suction, automatically, because of this unit, the piston pushed, there is an axial movement, this gets disengaged. So priming is done. So without priming, any centrifugal pump. So that's why we always say centrifugal pump needs priming. It cannot handle air. But the question now is, how the turbocharger employer is managing the scavenger supply to your engine? One is the design, because that's not a shrouded impeller, it is an open impeller, you might have seen. Turbocharger blower, it's a open, it is not shrouded. And it is made out of the material, you see, it is generally aluminium alloy. Have you seen the blower? Aluminium alloy, it's a light metal, not heavy. And again the RPM, what sort of RPM we are talking about? This type of pumps, 1200, 1400, 1600, not more than that. Whereas your turbocharger, what is the RPM of your generator turbocharger?
30,000.
And your main engine, big turbocharger, maybe about 16,000, 18,000. So the RPM is so high, and the profile of the blade and the design of your impeller, it is open. So there the requirement is also different. In a pump you need comparatively a higher pressure, but there you want it to handle air, draw the air, more volume. That means air pressure is not very much, you know your scavenge pressure. Is it about 10 bar? How much is your scavenge pressure when your engine is running full away? So it's not a question of pressure, it's a question of more volume of air has to be. That means the volume of air, or you can say the mass of volume of air should be more to increase the power output from the engine. So there the priorities change, functional requirement varies. So you can highlight these points. So that means with a turbocharger air blower, where the requirement is to create a less pressure and push in more volume of air to the scavenge, to the engine for combustion, there it performs well. There the blower handles air. But that you cannot compare here with the pump, because the pump impeller is designed to handle only liquid. Any liquid, it can be water, it can be oil. See, you see, the other day we talked about chemical tanks. There it is liquid chemical, it can be acid. Or last class, in my class, we were talking about a pump in a gas carrier. Liquefied. We looked at pumping system. What we said, deep well pumps or submerged pumps. Basically, if you look at all these pumps, the pump concept is centrifugal pump. What is that? But you are able to see me and you can see the board.
Yes, sir.
So now you understand. So this you will be looking at it. So your turbocharger air blower, it's not a problem. At a lower pressure, larger volume of air has to be supplied for scavenging purpose to improve the power output. So there it performs well. But the air here is a detrimental factor. This air has to be removed. So priming is required for a centrifugal pump. So the advantage and the disadvantage. Okay. Now, with this, we will move on. Let us just look at a centrifugal pump, what we have in the pump room of a tanker, oil tank. So in an oil tanker, you have your tank. So you have so much of oil. And where is the pump room? Pump room is going to be something like this. What is this? This is your cargo oil tank. Something like this. Now where is your pump? Your pump is here. Cargo oil pump. So much of oil, cargo pump, and this is the suction bell mouth and the suction valve. So when you open this, now let's say you have a discharge line like this going to the manifold. So when you open, see, there are valves here, The moment you open all these valves, then what will happen? Open this valve, open this valve, open this valve. Automatically the liquid will come up to this level, correct? No?
Yes.
That means priming is done. Why? Because your pump is full. That means prior discharging, prior commencing discharging. So that means the moment you open, the automatically the pump is primed. So now I am not going to look at the discharge side. Let us look at only on the suction side. Now tell me, what are all the factors that help the pump to take suction? I am going to look at only from here right up to the pump. On the discharge side, as of now, I am not looking at. What are the factors that help the pump to take suction? And what are the factors which affect or resist, offer some resistance? So if I just compare both, let me make a small tank here, so that, so suppose if I may, you know, what are the positive factors, what are the negative factors for the pump to take suction? What are the positive factors? What do you have here?
IG pressure.
So you have IG, okay, you have IG. Anything else? Only IG? Now what do we have in this classroom?
Atmosphere.
Atmosphere. Do we have now? Do we have atmosphere?
Yes.
But do we have it here? No?
More than atmosphere.
That means atmosphere pressure is also there. Then you have something more. So that means atmospheric pressure plus IG pressure. That means IG pressure is always more. How much more? Normally how much IG pressure we keep in the tank?
0.5.
So generally this IG pressure will be how much? 0.5 bar. 0.05. I think earlier also we talked about it. You always, but we don't say in terms of bar.
Millimeter
water bar. So it is generally 500 or 600, 700, whatever. Even if it is 500, it is going to be 0.05 bar, if at all you want to say in bar. But you know, we don't use the term, you know, bar. We always say 500, 400, millimeter water bar or millibar. You all know, one bar is equal to roughly 10 meter water column. Now, what are the positive factors? I can say, one is atmospheric pressure. Atmospheric pressure is going to push it. I am talking about only on the suction side. And what is the other one? IG. That means I have IG pressure also here. IG pressure is also going to push the liquid down to the pump, so that the pump can handle. Anything else I have?
Static.
Hmm?
Static head.
Okay, now the static head is this much. From here to the eye of the impeller. Now let us say something like this, more or less. How much is the height of liquid? This is the positive suction head, as we have seen before. Positive suction head. Okay, now that is your head. Now in the IG pressure, here I also add one more thing. What is it? Trim. Have you noticed? Trim is required or not? Whenever you discharge cargo in a tanker, your ship is always like this. Trim by?
Stern.
No, you must have seen, especially when you go down, right down to the stripping stage. The stripping stage, you will find ship is like this. Tankers, have you seen? You go 3 meters, 4 meters. That helps. So these are the positive factors. Okay, now what are the negative factors? Now I just draw a line here. Now what are the negative factors? These are the positive factors which helps the pump to take suction. Now I am looking for negative factors which is going to affect the pumping. Bell mouth is kept like this, you know, that is mainly for why we are having that bell mouth, something to cover more suction area. People say that it is now static charges also is getting reduced. by doing all that, you know. But otherwise, what are the negative factors?
Coffee.
What are the factors which will affect the performance of the pump?
Friction loss.
Suppose I have here fuel oil. See, fuel oil at 60 degrees Celsius. Or I am having naphtha. Or I am having MGO. Does it make a difference?
Yes.
In the pump performance?
Yes.
Is it only viscosity? Anything else?
Density, viscosity.
Now tell me, any centrifugal pump, a heated fuel oil or petrol, which the pump will be very comfortable with? Performance wise,
heated fuel oil
at 60 degrees. So, because why I am telling you heated, if I just say fuel oil, then the fuel oil is viscous, viscosity, the pump performance may drop. That is why purposely I am telling you fuel oil at heated at a temperature 60. Now, you said no, fuel oil, the pump will be, performance will be better with heated fuel oil. Why?
Density is more than petrol.
See, your fuel oil at 60 degrees centigrade is not going to give out any vapor. If any liquid that gives out vapor, then you are in trouble. No, the pump, centrifugal pump, we have already seen it is not comfortable with air or vapor. So that means petrol or fuel oil, if you just see, or petrol or diesel, if you see, diesel, it doesn't evaporate that easily, but petrol, possibility of vapors coming. If vapors coming in, then the pump performs. So somebody said, what is it called? Vapor pressure. Now, vapor pressure is a very, very important factor. Every liquid has got vapor pressure. So, higher the vapor pressure, you are in trouble. Higher the vapor pressure means what? Volatility. So, in case if the pressure, vapor pressure is higher, then what is going to happen? Then the vapor possibility of vapor. If the pump is handling liquid plus vapor, plus, you know, liquid come vapor, then again the question of the pump is not comfortable with vapor. So that is why vapor pressure is a very, very important factor. So now this is on the negative side, vapor pressure. Then apart from that, you can call it line friction. When you say line friction, what are all the factors we take into consideration? Just now you have said viscosity. Pipe length, pipe dia, length, bends, isn't it? Passing through valves, you know, how many bends you have, what is the length of the pipe, what is the diameter of the pipe, how viscous the cargo. Suppose the viscosity is more, then it will find it difficult. Viscosity, as all of you are aware, it is called internal resistance. So these are all the factors eventually giving what do we call line friction. So that is line friction is here. And then we have one more, what do we call this? What is the other negative factor? Net positive suction head. What happened? Your eyes are closed. Go wash your face and come. What happened? Last night you didn't sleep? Leave your book. Don't put water there also. Because his book is also sleeping. So now just look at it. Your positive factors are there for the pump to take suction. There are negative factors are there. But suppose if I just draw a line here like this, That means you have more positive factors than negative factors. So what will happen? The pump will take suction, not a problem. Okay, now the pump starts discharging. Then what will happen? Slowly, this will reduce. Because cargo is going to the store tank. Then finally, what will happen? You will have something like this. Now both are same. Now this is your what? Head. Then where does the head, where does the cargo gone? Because the cargo has gone to shore. Now from this level, it has come down to this level. Now what is going to happen? Now both are same. That means the positive factors and negative factors are same. Now the pump is not, probably it is not going to take suction. It is going to lose suction. It's a very critical situation. Suppose if you run the pump as it is, what will happen? So cavitation will set in. The pump, at one stage you will find nothing will come out. Pump is running. Yeah, it is running a pump and pump not taking sense. Pump will run. Pump will not stop as long as the frame over is on. But output is not going to be there. And you said cavitation. What is cavitation? You tell me cavitation. Explain cavitation. Come on, man.
Sir, I'm not solo.
Huh? What is
the
cavitation?
Due to air bubbles, there will be a small air pockets. Impeller like that, sir.
Tell me in English. You will answer like this in orals. Talk in English only. Actually, what is the cavitation?
Sir,
explain cavitation.
When a vapor bubble impinges on the impeller, it will make a cavitation.
When a vapor bubble
impinges on the impeller.
Impinges on the impeller.
Impeller. There will be some erosion type. It will take place.
Where? Only in the impeller?
Yes,
okay. From where does this vapor bubble came?
Into pressure difference.
No, wait. Let me. From where does the vapor bubble came? No? Can you answer? Bruce, yes. What is cavitation? Explain.
Cavitation is due to the impingence of vapor bubbles on the impeller surface.
From where the vapor bubbles, from where they, you are telling the same thing what he said. From where the vapor bubbles have come now?
It's a vacuum space, sir.
I want him to answer now why you are answering. I have other questions for you. Pretty much. When I come to you, I'll ask other questions. Yes, tell me. Samar, you tell me. What is cavitation? I want each one of you to understand. No, it's not the only one person. You are always interacting. But there are many people not interacting. I want to interact with people who are not interacting. Tell me, what is cavitation?
Due to pressure difference.
Okay.
Vapor bubbles are formed.
You see, please understand. Vapor bubbles are formed. You said, vapor bubbles. From where does the vapor bubble come? Because what is happening now? Suppose, what is the right way of starting the centrifugal pump? Always close the discharge valve and suction valve is fully open. Always when you start the pump, your suction valve is always full open. Discharge valve is fully closed. Then slightly, then start the pump. Maybe at a lower RPM if possible. Because some pumps will have a variable speed, whereas some pumps will have a straight, direct, only single speed. Like for example, your motors on in the engine room, you all have same speed, no? But in some ships, you may find your main seawater pump may have two speeds, upper speed and lower speed, upper speed. So always when you start, but when you start the pump with the delivery valve closed, what will happen? Do you have a relief valve?
for centrifugal pump. But what about gear pump, you have a relief valve?
Yes.
Screw pump, you have a relief valve? When you have relief valve for all other pumps, why only for centrifugal pump you don't have relief valve? Because when you close the delivery valve fully and when the pump is running, then what happens? The pumping action stops. There is no pressure rise. So, only thing what will happen is, even if the pump is taking suction, slowly, slowly, slowly throttle and close the delivery valve, then pumping will not, whatever liquid that is there in the casing, the impeller keeps rotating, thereby slowly heating it up. So it will get warm, it will get heat. For a longer period, you are not supposed to run it with the delivery valve closed. You understand? Whereas here, there is no relief valve. If the relief valve is there, then it is a different story. So now, coming back, with the centrifugal pump running, in case if there is any obstruction, or in case if there is any valve is closed, or it is coming with an obstruction, then what will happen? At the eye of the impeller, you are going to have some under pressure. And there is this liquid has always have some vapor pressure. And just look at any point of time, in case at the eye of the impeller, the pressure at the eye, if it happens to be less than the vapor pressure, then what will happen? The incoming liquid is going to evaporate. That is what is happening. So sometimes, you know, people tell me, air bubbles. It is not the air bubble. So because of this pressure difference, you said pressure difference, but pressure difference, little more elaboration is required there. Because due to some obstruction at the eye of the impeller, yes, under pressure. Because when the liquid is exposed to the under pressure, if that pressure falls below the vapor pressure of that liquid, then evaporation takes place. When evaporation takes place, what happens? The liquid boils. So then it turns into mostly vapor and liquid. Now that goes through the gate veins towards the periphery. When that happens, then what happens to the bubble?
Collapse.
But this bubble collapsing or breaking, it happens within the gate vein as well as it may happen in the casing also. It is not restricted only on to the impeller. You can see, when you dismantle any of the centrifugal pump or overall, look at the gate veins, look at the impeller critically, you know, with a torch, just to see the shrouded area. Any of you have done it? You have done it? Which one? Cargo pump?
No, sir. Normal. Seawater pump.
Seawater pump. So the impeller you have inspected. Have you seen any fitting marks? You see fitting marks. And you will also see in the casing. In the worst case scenario, what will happen? Because of the fitting, the casing will get even like a corrosion hole. Small holes will happen to that extent. So you have to avoid this cavitation business. So have you understood now, Ashish? The cavitation happens because, so that's the reason we always say there should not be any restriction on the suction side of the centrifugal pump in your engine. Don't throttle the valve. Keep the valve full open. So if you do that, then cavitation possible. But now here it is going to be, cavitation is going to start. So how will you pump out this? Now this particular liquid is still there. If you all, now what are the symptoms of cavitation?
Vibration.
Yes, because when the pump is running, there is some rhythm. You can make out. But now the rhythm will change. So the pump will vibrate. The sound, you know, the rhythm will change. It vibrates if you just go and feel. So even in tankers, you know, when your COPs are running, when the cavitation sets in, but you cannot allow the pump to run in cavitation condition for a longer time, because it's going to be detrimental. It's going to damage the pump in the long run. So now what will you do? Either you have to increase all this, or you have to either increase this or decrease this. Then there will be some difference, correct? Then only you will be able to. Is it possible to increase this? You cannot. Atmospheric pressure, you will not be able to. Now what about this IG pressure? IG pressure, can you increase? But restrictions apply. How much you can increase? It is already 800 mm. So you can go to 1000 or 1400. You cannot keep on increasing. So slight increase you can do. Same thing with the trim also. Let's say your ship is already having a 3 meter trim. Or you may have like 4 meter trim you can go. Then, but then you cannot give the ship like this. So you have restrictions here. You can slightly increase. Okay. So by doing it, what will happen? This may come somewhere here. So that this much you will be able to discharge. But anything you can reduce it? Vapor pressure can you reduce?
No, sir.
Can you reduce vapor pressure? No. It depends upon the characteristics of that particular liquid. So you will not be able to do anything here. Now what about this line friction? Line friction, can you reduce? Yes or no?
Yes.
You can do heating. That means the viscosity, you want to reduce the viscosity. Because see, one thing you must understand, line friction is proportional to flow velocity. So what is flow velocity? Line friction, if you want to reduce, you have to reduce the flow velocity. Flow velocity means what? Like somebody said, heat, okay, viscosity, try to reduce. But more than that, you other things you will not be able to do, because the length of the suction pipe or the number of valves what you have, number of bends what you have, diameter of the pipe, these are all infrastructural. It's all nothing you can change. But to some extent, somebody said viscosity. Okay, viscosity. If it is viscous, you can try to do. That will reduce the line friction. But the main point is flow velocity. Flow velocity means what? Rate at which the liquid flows, or in eventually you can relate it to the pump RPM. Earlier the pump was running at 1400 RPM. But now what you can do is, if you want to reduce the line friction from 1400 RPM, now reduce it to about 1200. So when you reduce the RPM, pump RPM, say from 1400 RPM, earlier the pump was running, now to about say, let us say 1100 RPM you are reducing. When you do that, then what will happen? Now this will reduce. Okay, now this NPSH required also will reduce. Now what is NPSH? We will see now. So if you put this, let us say now this is the NPSH. That means what? Again, positive factors are more. So comfortably you will be able to discharge. Is it understood? So people from tankers, what do we do when you are stripping? When you are about to, when the cargo is about to, the last part of stripping, when the cargo is going to end in a tank, we always, have you seen, we reduce
RPM.
So that's what line friction is proportional to the flow velocity. Flow velocity is nothing but your rate of discharge. That depends upon the RPM. Apart from that, the reduction in viscosity and all that, it's all minor. Yes, you can attempt. Have you understood this? Now, next question. What is this NPSH required? So who will be able to tell me? What is NPSH? All of you have come across this, you know, net positive suction head. What is it?
Rectal.
You tell me.
Actually, it's a suction head required for the pump to take suction. Required net positive suction means available net positive suction to others. Required means what that pump, while listening what they will say, it will take suction from other side. So whenever we have to implement some pump on that area, we have to check what is the actual height it is going to take. I mean, if
who decides, sir?
The design manufacturer.
Okay, how does he come to that value? How does he know that for this pump net positive suction, how does he check? Okay, he has designed, but then he has to check, always, you know, all of you have seen with your pumps, always there is a manual there, your pump manual. So the pump manual, you will always see NPSH required is also given. So how do they find out? See, net positive suction head required. See, there are two things here. One is required, the other one is available. As long as the available NPSH is more than required, then your pump will take suction. Not a problem. But due to some reason, if available NPSH is less than required, then you have problem. Then the pump will not take suction. Okay, but the required one, how do they decide? The designer, as you rightly said, the designer. So it is something like this, you know, very simple to understand. Let us say you have a container with water. And this is the centrifugal pump. You have dropped the centrifugal pump inside it. It has got a flexible suction and it has got a discharge pipe like this. Now this pump is running now. The pump is having what? Positive suction head? So now the pump is having positive suction head. So not a problem. Pump will run. So pump is running and water is coming. But what is this? This is a flexible suction hose. Pump is running already. Now slightly lift the pump to this level. This is your suction and this is your, okay. Now the pump will run.
Yes.
Now also the pump is having positive suction head. So you will find water coming. The pump is running already. Now here also pump running. Okay. Now what happens? As long as the pump is below the water level, not a problem. But suppose if I from the pump I am slowly taking out of water, just above the water level, I am bringing it out somewhere here. Now this is the suction hose and this is the pipe. Now what will happen to the pump now? Will it take suction or not? If it is just at the surface, slightly above water, probably yes. Then what I am doing? Slowly, I am just lifting it up. You will find at one particular height, or now it is what is turning into from suction head into suction lift. Okay, so as and when I keep raising it, at one point, let us say when the pump is somewhere here, the pump stops. Here water is coming. Here nothing is coming. Now what has happened? Pump has lost suction. So now this, if you measure this, now this is what is called. As long as the available NPSH is less than that, the pump will function. If it is more, then the pump will not. Have you understood? So for every pump, they always give net positive suction head required. Now this is done in the pump manufacturer's test bed. He does a lot of tests like this. And then he puts it so that when you install the pump on board in your engine room, wherever you install, you need to make sure. See, if you look at your FSS code, it very clearly tells you, as per your FSS code, your centrifugal pumps, you know, your main fire pumps, where they are need to be located. Can you keep your fire pump on the upper deck?
No.
Where is the location?
Bottom.
You will find in the engine room below the floor plates, as closer to the keel as possible. Because why? Because whether it is loaded passage or whether it is a ballast passage, the pump still should take suction. So they locate the pump in such a way, the pump is always getting positive suction. At the moment you open the sea chest, from the sea chest when the valve, when the water is rushing in, the pump must be able to take, especially your fire pump. Fire pump, your main sea water pump, all those pumps are like that. Have you understood now? What is net positive suction head?
Just touching the water level. That time the pump is taking suction. Little bit lift we are giving. That time also taking suction. At this point it loses suction. So from that point only they are calculating.
Yeah. You see, but suction pipe means no, suction pipe is inside. Only the impeller, eye of the impeller I am talking about. It's not the, suppose if the water is here and you have a pump, this is the, and you have a suction pipe like this. If it is above, will it take suction?
No.
So what I am trying to say is, this is down. I am just talking about a flexible suction pipe. This has to be, you know, because see in this pipe, up to water level is up to this. But when you keep on rising at one level, the pump will lose suction. Now at that time, just to see eye of the impeller. And the water bottle. But here the pipe should go down. It cannot be above the pipe, suction pipe cannot be above. Otherwise, how will it take? Then it will take air only.
So, for the centrifugal pump like this, I'm thinking of this built-in pump, sir.
Forget about built-in pump, don't bring it now. Now we are talking about centrifugal pump. Each pump has got built-in pump, is what? Your diaphragm pump, no?
Yes, sir.
Diaphragm pump is a different ballgame. Why you are talking about it now? Now our discussion should, we need to talk only, think about centrifugal pump now. When we complete centrifugal pump related questions, if you have anything, you tell me now. Have you understood so far?
Yes, sir.
Don't bring in welded pump, don't bring in screw pump, because those are all called, you know, positive displacement pump is different. Because if you see the total, you know, the broad classification is what, when you are looking at pumps, on one side we have positive displacement. Positive displacement pump, like for example, you have, you know, for your bilge duty on board in the engine room, what type of pump is that?
Piston.
That is a piston pump. That is a reciprocating pump. That is positive displacement. Positively, anything that comes in, whether it is water or whether it is air or whatever, you know, that will get displaced. That's not a problem. Now we are talking about restriction only about centrifugal pump I am talking about. Okay, have you understood this? So this one? Okay, now I want to ask you, now this one part of it I'll just rub it off. Let us just make, you know, have you seen these graphs? Every pump manual has got some graphs. Now what is that graph? How do you make this? People call it QH curve, or it is called a characteristic curve. Characteristic or performance curve. You know, there are different names given, no? QH curve, performance curve. By looking at the curves, you will be able to see what sort of performance. So how do you make? Now you have water entering into the centrifugal pump, and let us say at the same level you are discharging. See, the pump is running here and water is coming. At the same level you are. Now how much is the head here? Head is zero. There is no head. Because at the same level, the pump is here, at the same level you are. So the flow rate. The flow rate is maximum because absolutely no head. Now what happens in this pipe, discharge pipe? There is one vertical pipe like this. I keep a pipe like this. And there is a valve here. Okay, now the valve is open. As long as the valve is open, the pump is discharging here. Now let us say this pump is running at 1200 RPM. Okay, now slowly, slowly, what do? I close this pump. Then what will happen to the liquid? So now what is happening? Now the liquid is rising in this. Now let us say, this is an open pipe like this, so it stops somewhere here. Okay, suppose if the capacity of the pump is higher, then probably it may overflow also. But I am assuming, now the pump running at 1200 RPM, the liquid stops here. Now this valve is closed. So pump keeps running. This is equivalent to running a pump with the discharge valve fully closed. But the liquid which has gone up in the vertical pipe is not going to go any further higher. Why? Because if you take out the pump and put another pump of a higher capacity, then probably it will go. So it stops there. Now just imagine here there is an imaginary line like this, like this, like this. You know, imaginary line. And imaginary line means what? Just assume that there is a pipe and you have a valve here, another valve here, another valve here. All these valves are closed. Now what I am doing, with this valve closed, the liquid reaches this point. Now I slowly open this valve, then what will happen? That means water will come here, it will not reach. The moment since I opened this valve, now the liquid will start flowing here. Correct? The pump is running, the water is not flowing. And if I open this valve, then water will not go up. Even though this valve is open, the water will not go. Because the flow of water will be, it will take the line of least resistance. What is least resistance? Now this is the least resistance. Even though the valve is open, the moment I open this valve, the liquid will rise like this and then starts going in this. Now tell me, the flow rate here, the flow rate here, will there be a difference?
Yes.
Where the flow rate will be more? There will be more. Here is less. Now the moment I open this, again here, the flow rate is more. That means, at this point is no flow rate. Now at this height, some flow rate. Now at this head, some other flow rate. You mean the flow rate is slowly
Increasing.
Now suppose if I can mark all this, if I cover, then I am going to get a line like this. Yes or no? So now what has happened? Now this is the flow rate at this level. This is the flow rate at this level. And this is the flow rate at this level. Now that you have understood, now all these are imaginary lines, forget it. Now, just consider this is 0, 0. Now your y-axis. Y-axis is what? Meter liquid column. Meter liquid column. This is the height. This is your y-axis. Now your x-axis is what? Q. So the unit here is cubic meter per hour. Now this is your flow rate. So you are going to get a graph like this. Okay. Now for example, now just imagine now. Have you understood this graph? How the graph is drawn? That means when the resistance is more, the moment I open this valve, then what will happen? The flow rate will be maximum. So when the head is zero, flow rate is this. As and when the head keeps increasing, the flow rate keeps on reducing, then finally, you get only the head and there is no flow rate when it is a maximum head. So this is what we call QH curve. Now this is Q and this is your H. So a QH performance curve is formed like this. Any questions? All of you understood this? These are all the basics of centrifugal pump, understanding the curves. If you have any issues, feel free to ask me. Unless otherwise you understand this, you will not be able to go further. Now, let us say, now this pump is handling, now listen to me. Now this pump is handling diesel oil with a specific gravity of about 0.85. And with the valve closed, it came here. That means the diesel oil, what is the specific gravity? 85. Now this is the point. Now suppose, if I run the same pump, same capacity pump, but instead of diesel oil, 0.85, I am using fuel oil. And the fuel oil, specific gravity is 0.98. So, now with the valve closed, when I run the same pump, with a different fluid, with a different liquid, now what will happen? Your fuel oil will be, with the diesel oil it came up to this. With fuel oil, will it go up or will it go down?
Go up.
Or same?
Go up.
What do you think? What will happen?
Go up.
Is it same or is it, will it go up?
Same.
It will decrease. No, let me hear different people. No, somebody says same, but here he says, you say decrease. What is the reason?
Because it is a centrifugal pump, it depends on mass. So as density increases, mass will increase.
But is it yet? The pump is running, in a primed condition only. Primed condition only it is running, so this valve is closed, so the liquid is going to go. But the column, will it be the same level or higher or lower? Now who said same? You said same. Can you explain? Why do you say it is same?
So the head will remain the same because the head depends on what height your liquid is going to pump. Maybe the only thing that will change will be the discharge pressure pumping fuel oil.
So do you, what about this side? All of you agree? What he says? What do you think?
Sir, obviously, the lesser dense oil is less pressure. Higher denser oil is more.
Now I am not talking about pressure. I am talking about only meter liquid column. Only yes. Head. Only head.
Yes, sir. Obviously, the pressure is proportional to the head.
So the right answer is it will remain at the same height. Whether it is diesel oil or whether it is fuel oil or whether it is water, whatever is the fluid, whatever is the liquid that the pump is handling, irrespective of the density, the head reached for this capacity of this pump is same, both are same. But as he said rightly, suppose if I keep a pressure gauge here, how much pressure is going to show? Now this pressure, always you know, what is pressure? This is the formula for pressure, no? So what is rho?
Density.
Now the density is going to vary. G, same. H, same. Or in other words, P is proportional to rho. So what will happen? If it is going to be diesel oil, it will show some pressure. It is going to be heavy oil, then the pressure will vary. Have you understood this? Now, the head, probably because of this density variation, the time taken for the liquid to reach there, maybe a slight variation can be there. Otherwise, the head will be same. Whereas the pressure will vary because of this. Okay, now this is one input for you.
Water means?
Water also same. Any liquid. Any liquid. Even if it is water. If it is water, is one. Water also will be same. Now, have you understood this graph and this concept of the pressure variation, head remaining same irrespective of the density? So now, let us see, where is your GS pump fitted, fire pump fitted in the engine room, correct? Now the pump is designed as per your requirements of SOLAS or FSS code requirement. It must be able to, can anyone tell me what is the SOLAS requirement for your fire pump?
Emergency fire pump.
The pump must be capable of lifting the liquid all the way from the dump, not bridge, even to your mangale. Where is the highest hydrant you have?
Bridge
wing, or maybe on top also still. So the pump capacity should be designed in such a way the water is lifted all the way right up to that particular point. Now whatever you say, or in the case of an oil tanker, what is happening? In an oil tanker, I think I have already rubbed it off. In an oil tanker, what is the pump is there? Where is in the pump room? Your COP is going to be right at the bottom. The pump has to lift the cargo or oil all the way to the main deck level, and main deck level also you have at the midship, you are having a manifold. That's a, you have a manifold, no? That means the pump is designed to lift the liquid right up to the manifold. Now this is going to remain same whichever port you go. So the pump from the eye of the impeller to the uppermost height where the hydrant is supposed, I am talking about a fire pump, hydrant discharge, that height will remain same. That is not going to change. Now take that height, that is called static head. Now take that static head and put it here. Now that static head is this one. What is it called? Static head. That means, as per your requirements of FSS code or SOLAS, what should be the discharge rate? Now this is the static head, and what is the discharge rate? Now the pump is designed to discharge a Q at a head of, you get the point? Now this is the head, designed head. Now this particular point we call, what do we call? DP. DP means what? Design point. That means your pump is designed to deliver the required pressure as per your guidelines. Any of you remember what is the FSS code requirement? The fire pump, discharge pressure. There are two things given. One is the pressure, the other one is what? Flow rate. You need to comply with the FSS code requirement for your fire pump. One is pressure, the second thing is flow rate. Now, what is the flow rate? Now, this is the flow rate. Because this is going to remain same. Okay, maybe within the engine room when you open a fire hydrant, maybe the flow rate may be more because head is less. But where is the head? The highest head is right on top, not even bridge wing, maybe in the monkey. Now that is where the head, that is the static head, the pump is designed to deliver that particular flow rate at that particular point,
highest point.
Now that, how do you say this graph? This static head you cut. Now see, now this is what we call design point. You see, your pump is not going to operate here because always are you going to have this much head, always you have. So that is why always you will find when you talk about H, Q, always, you know, the flow rate, the HQ curve is made like this, they don't come right down. Because your operating range always, always operating range is somewhere here, this range only. You are not going to operate here. You are not going to run the pump with your delivery valve fully closed. At the same time, the head is not going to be zero. So now this is what is called the operating range. So this is a design head, this is your static head, and this is the design pressure. This is DP, design point, and this is your Q, this is the static head. Have you understood? These are the fundamental basics you must understand, understanding the curve.
Will there be any difference, like if it is a 10-year-old, this thing, so if this curve will change, or it will be for a design, particular design, it will be constant?
Because the required quantum, quantity of rate of discharge, as per the requirement is this. What will happen now when you say the, it's not the question of 10-year-old or 5-year-old, it depends upon how many number of hours. Wear and tear of your impeller. Suppose if your impeller, there are holes due to cavitation. Then what will happen? There will be some short cycling within the impeller. Then the flow rate will get affected. The pump is running at 1200 RPM, but the flow rate is not what it is supposed to be at that head. See, that has happened because of wear and tear of that component. So casing ring clearance, you are giving a track. You are supposed to know.
Yes, yes.
You check no casing ring clearance. If the casing ring clearance is more, what will happen?
Yes,
okay, that is one thing. Due to cavitation, if there are any gateways, if there are any holes, or you know, all those, then there again your performance drops down. So whenever performance drops down, then you need to check. So that is why you have your PMS, and periodically we open up the pump and see. So all the centrifugal pumps, or for that matter any machinery, this is what it is. When performance deteriorates, that means there is some issue. That means you need to carry out some maintenance part of it. So it's not the question of 5 years or 10 years.
No, I meant like if it is not delivering so much this thing, then we should be over.
Yes,
so
yes.
That's what I mean.
Yes, yes. The moment you see there is a drop in performance, then you need to check. You need to check. So that is why, you know, when we do, why do we have this PMS, you know, that is planned maintenance, all right? Or you can also say, you can also call it preventive maintenance. Now, preventive maintenance is better than breakdown maintenance. There are two things, one is breakdown, the other one is preventive. If you don't do preventive maintenance when it is required to be done, then eventually it will, it's like your car, man. Yes, you said something.
If the pump has two RPMs, sir, one low and one high, then it will have two curves, sir.
Yes, yes, naturally. See, no, this curve, when I am drawing this curve, see, what is my assumption? 1200. Suppose, if this RPM, if I make it 1000 RPM, then I may not get this, then I am going to get like this.
So, the head depends on the RPM, the maximum head
depends. Yes, naturally. So, now, this is 1200. Now, for 1100 or 1000, let me write 1000. Now, so then what happens? At this 1000, my flow rate reduces, and this also will go like this. It's a parallel. You have to draw parallel. Have you understood? Okay, we'll take a break. A pump is running like this. If you alter the RPM, if you reduce the RPM, then what will happen? From 1200 RPM, it is 1000 RPM. Or if you increase the RPM, it will become like this. Okay. But sometimes, suppose if you run another pump, sometimes what do? We run two pumps in parallel. One pump is running, let us say there is one pump running here, and you start one more pump, then what will happen? how the curve will vary. See, this is one pump, this is another pump. Now this pump is joining. Now this is your discharge. So now this is pump number one, pump number two. You have discharge valve, suction valve. So this pump is running initially. Okay, suppose if you start this pump also like this, then what will happen? Both the pumps are running in parallel. Sometimes pump can run in series. Now in parallel. So with this is with one pump. So what will happen if I just run the second pump? Second pump will become, now this is one and this is two.
Okay.
One pump. So this is with one pump. Huh? So what has happened now? Suppose if this is your static head, with one pump running, your Q, how much was the Q? Q1. This is Q2. So by running the second pump in parallel with the first pump, so what do you achieve? That your Q, in fact, effectively, it may not be exactly like this, it will be probably like this. Now, you make it like this. So now this is your Q. So by running two pumps in parallel, you may not get double the rate, because earlier I have drawn here. So now what has happened with one pump? Now this is your Q. By running the second pump in parallel, there is an increase in the flow rate, but it will not double, since because two pumps are running. But what has happened? It has increased. Now this is your Q1, this is your Q2. Okay, like for example, if you take a pump, your seawater pump is running and passing through heat exchangers. That means heat passing through heat exchangers means what exactly is happening? Like you take your lubile cooler. When the water is flowing through the lubile cooler, what is that? That means there is some back pressure.
Yes.
Seawater is entering the heat exchanger. And then it is passing through the tubes. Suppose if you have a heat exchanger like this, here you have a division plate, but here also you have one in, one out. No, so let us say sea water in, but here also you will have a division plate. No, so here you may not have. So what will happen? So you have your tubes like this. So what will happen? Water will enter, go through the tubes, and then it's going to go. This is a two run. You can make it two run, or you can make it four run also. So now this is your seawater. Now what is happening? The water is coming here and it is passing through the tubes. That means what exactly is happening? There is some
friction.
So now what is going to be the flow rate after the heat exchanger? The flow rate will reduce. Now that can be projected here by drawing a curve like this. You can call it back pressure curve. Back pressure. Back pressure curve means what? In case if the pump is running without the heat exchanger, the flow rate with one pump was this one. But with the back pressure introduced now, this is your back pressure. So now what has happened? Now the Q1 is not this. Now the Q1 has reduced. How much is the Q1? Now reduce this much. How this reduction has taken place now? Actual Q1 is this. I am talking about after the heat exchanger. So like for example, whenever you do cargo discharge on board an oil tanker, have you seen at the manifold you have a reducer? So if you have a reducer, what will happen? Back pressure will increase. Okay. So that will have an effect in the flow rate. Flow rate will definitely decrease. Or in on board an oil tanker, you are having at the manifold you have a reducer, and after the manifold you have a chicken, you know, joining your loading arm, you can call it. After that it goes to the short tank. At what rate the oil is reaching the short tank? At a slower rate because of this back pressure. So now this back pressure even if two pumps run in parallel also, now this is Q2, now not this, now Q2 will be this one. Okay, definitely there is an increase. But because of the back pressure, always what will happen? You will find there is some reduction in the flow rate. Have you understood? Back pressure curve.
Even
one is back pressure, the other one is parallel running. Yes.
Two pumps are running and it is not double because of back pressure only. Like the back pressure created by the one.
Two pumps are running?
Two pumps are running, sir. And after, if it is going like 6 mm pipe, they both meet and it is a 10 mm pipe from there, will there be like the flow matter?
You are talking about here?
Yeah.
Okay, you mean to say this is 6 mm?
Yeah, like the from these two are 6 mm and the pipe from where from after that is after where they meet is 10 mm. So it will be less back pressure. Like
correct. You mean to say this is a smaller pipe? This is a smaller pipe, but then this is a bigger pipe.
Yes.
The flow rate variation will occur. Flow rate variation will occur. But then if you just look at the again, if you just look at your question paper in your examination, in your EK general, where they are asking about centrifugal pump, I remember this question. That is why I am just thinking about it. Okay, now let me ask you one question. Like many in Dubai pump, you take Dubai pump. See, you can have a centrifugal pump as a Dubai pump, or you can have a double helical screw pump in some ships. Of late, you will find more and more ships are having centrifugal pumps. What is the advantage? Why we are having? How many of you had centrifugal pump as main engine mobile pump? I think many of you. What about you?
Double helical.
Double helical screw. You also had?
Centrifugal.
What about you?
Screw pump.
Screw pump. Now which is better? Screw pump is better? Again, I am just asking you this question because I remember, I think that's one of your... written.
No, sir, more of the air, sir. Huh? If the engine is bigger, it will be better centrifugal because more flow.
So now, for this question, now let me again, since now that it is confused, now let me just draw a line. Because graphically, you need to explain how this affects. Now this is Q, this is H, and now this is your one pump, centrifugal pump, the Lubail pump. Okay. Now the lubail pump, where is the lubail pump fitted? Lubail pump is fitted, it is called a tank lubail pump because it is in the lubail sump. Have you seen? The pump is in the sump with the motor. It's a vertical pump, the motor is driving. But the pump is located in the lubail sump, not right at the bottom, maybe slightly high. But what is the advantage? Your lubail sump always you will be able to sound. That means lubail sump always you have oil. That means the pump is submerged. So that means the pump is always having positive suction head. You see, with reference to pump losing suction, that question does not arise because always you will maintain the lubail sump level. You know minimum sump level how much will it be. So the pump is always immersed. So that is one worry is over because the pump is always having positive because you can't afford to have any loss of suction in especially main engine lubail pump duty because that supplies not only piston bowling, it supplies your main engine lubail, bottom end bearing lubail and your cross end lubail. So if any such interruption or drop in oil pressure will have a devastating effect on the bearings. So but here by locating the pump, the advantages of having lubail pump, one thing is you locate the pump inside there, so always you have positive suction head. That is one thing. Now apart from that, your lubail pump is going to be something like this. I am talking about the QH curve. Because graphically you have to draw the diagram and then you will explain how it is better than your screw pump. Screw pump is a positive displacement pump. So for a positive displacement pump, can you just draw the QH curve? Now all of you have seen your centrifugal pump is going to be something like this. You can draw something like this. Okay. Now for a positive displacement pump, how the QH curve will be? Come on, draw. Let me see. All of you draw. Centrifugal pump I have already drawn and explained. Just, you just draw it for a positive displacement pump, for a screw pump. how will it be? Is it going to be like this? So how will it be? Have you drawn?
Straight line.
Straight line parallel. Like quantity is same.
Huh?
The quantity will be same, but the pressure will.
Straight line means vertical line.
Vertical.
Like this?
Vertical line.
Vertical line means suppose can I draw like this?
No.
The positive displacement pump is going to be something like this. I want to just run this. I want to make sure both these things are same. Now this is your positive displacement. This is centrifugal. So the pump is going to be something like this. You know your QH curve will be, may not be like this, maybe a little more. Okay? Because you all know that in a positive displacement pump, what do we have? We always have, can you run the pump with the delivery valve fully closed?
No.
No. Because from the name itself, you know, positively something will be discharged. So if you throttle or if you close the delivery valve, there will be a pressure rise and then it will damage your casing. So you always have a relief valve. Any positive displacement pump, let it be screw pump, let it be gear pump, you will always find there is a relief valve. In case of pressure boost, then what will happen? The relief valve will take over, like your boiler safety valve. Okay. Now this is how it is. This is how it is for a lube oil pump, main engine lube oil pump. Now this oil, when you start the pump initially, let us say your ship is in port for 4-5 days, and then you start your main engine lube oil pump. At that point of time, the oil is not very warm. Oil is cold, whatever is the temperature, your ambient temperature. Ambient temperature is about, let's say, 25 degrees. And your seawater temperature may be around 30 degrees centigrade. More than seawater temperature, it is the engine room temperature, which depends upon the ambient. So now this is how it is. Okay, but when the engine is running after some time, so what is going to happen? You are going to have some back pressure, no? Now let us say this is your back pressure is something like this. I will come back and I will just draw this positive displacement again. First, let us finish this. Normally, your this is cold oil. Now this is your rated discharge, but when you start your engine, when you start the pump, what will happen? The oil is comparatively cold. So that means more viscous. So it is not going to be like this. So it is going to be cold oil is like this. So cold oil for at the same point, if I am just running a positive displacement pump, is going to be something like this. So now this is what is going to be the flow rate. But in case if the oil becomes hot, so then what is going to happen? Now this is hot oil, no? With the hot oil, warm oil, instead of writing hot, let me write warm oil. With warm oil, what will happen to the viscosity? Drops. That means your back pressure, will it increase or decrease?
Decrease.
So back pressure has decreased. So now that back pressure has decreased, now what has happened? Originally, this was the Q cold oil, QC. Now where is the, with the warm oil, with reference to centrifugal pump, now this is centrifugal pump cold oil, centrifugal pump cold oil. Because with warm oil, what has happened? The back pressure has reduced. So from here, there is an increase in what? Flow rate. Whereas for a positive displacement pump, earlier it was, now where is it? This also has increased. But how much it is increased? It is going to be, are you able to follow? That means that increase here is going to be, yeah, there also the the flow rate has increased, but then how much it, the increment is going to be very less compared to your centrifugal pump. Are you able to see that? Huh? So what I'll do, I'll just to show you one. So you'll be able to see that, because I'm not probably if I just draw it like this, probably you'll know it little more better. So, you are able to see now, how much is the increment here? This is cold oil, this is warm oil. For warm oil, in case if it is a centrifugal pump, the rate of discharge has increased from here to here, considerable. Whereas, if it is going to be a screw pump, this is positive displacement. Screw pump, the increment from here to here is very less. What? Very less. So, you will find of late, they are using more of centrifugal pump
compared to positive.
Yeah, compared to positive displacement pump. 1 minute, let me just now just look at this. Now this is what I was just trying to show. Now this is the total head, this is the quantity. Now where is it gone? Now you see, now this is your centrifugal pump QH curve, and positive displacement pump head quantity like this. Okay, so earlier you see, now this one is called, see, now this back pressure curve, I have drawn it from here like this, I have drawn, correct? You can draw it from there or you can draw it from here also. Now here, system characteristic, cold oil, when the cold oil is there, it is like this. Now you see, now this is the point of intersection. So whether it is a positive displacement pump or a centrifugal pump, now how much is the Q? Now this much is the Q. Okay. Now when the oil becomes warm, what will happen when the engine is started slowly? The oil gets warm. So at that point of time, when that means what is happening? There is a drop in back pressure. When there is a drop in back pressure, then in case if it is going to be a centrifugal pump, the difference is this much. You see, between this centrifugal pump Q increase, how much is the Q increasing from here to here? Whereas for a positive displacement pump, how much is the Q increase? Are you able to see? So I remember this question a couple of times asked in your exam. So how will you, you have to draw something like this, and compare your positive displacement QH curve you draw, and any of you, if you want to draw, just draw it now. So here, compared to what I drew, but here it is, they made it little bigger and then flop, so that you can just draw this if you want. Any questions, ask me. Is it clear now? So the advantage of having centrifugal pumps, and apart from increase in volume, you must have noticed, you know, there is one more thing in centrifugal pump, pressure drop from here to here, whereas here positive displacement results in pressure drop from here to here. That means which is advantageous for you? Less pressure drop is always better. So centrifugal pump, the pressure drop there is less. So relative pressure drop is less and relative volume increase is more. So that way your centrifugal pump is more efficient. That is why of late you find many ships, you know, we have more number of centrifugal pump for lube oil pump duty. So you highlight both, you know, quantity as well as pressure.
What is that falling system resistance?
Yes, because the resistance will fall, no? Because of when you say back pressure drop, that means your resistance drops, you know. When there is a resistance, that is what we call back pressure. I mean, I gave an example earlier. No, so when it is passing through heat exchanger, that means what is happening? The liquid is allowed to flow through the tubes. Like for example, yes, I remember that question also. Suppose a heat exchanger. You have a division plate. Suppose if the division plate is corroded or if the division plate is broken, then what will happen? The liquid will bypass and it will short circuit. Because of that, the cooling efficiency will drop, but back pressure drop will not be there.
Flow will increase.
Yes, flow will increase, but then it's of no use because it's not doing the heat exchanger duty. So the back pressure concept can be, you know, like for example in reducer, wherever you use reducers or wherever you are using heat exchangers. So that we can go further. What are the components of centrifugal pump and all that? I think you all know that, you know. You just, if you see questions on centrifugal pump, generally you get in. Okay, now if I.
Same the thing, positive displacement pump, hot oil pressure drops a lot, only. Quantity flow rate increase and pressure drop a lot.
When you finish drawing, you tell me so that I'll move on. This concept, have you understood? The back pressure concept. Back pressure concept, and then also drawing the QH curve. How the QH curve is drawn. And the pressure formula, P is equal to rho GH. These are all the things you already studied. No, it's only you need a little bit of pressure. Even the centrifugal force formula. Okay. Now, where do we use the double volume casing, gentlemen? What is double volume casing? Can anyone tell me? What is double volume casing?
Two stage.
I am talking about double volute. Where is it used?
COP.
In the bigger,
COP
you have seen. Now, what is double volute casing? Again, it's there in your exam. Questions? What is double volute casing? Can you elaborate on that? Single volute, I think I drew it earlier. Okay. Shall I close this? Now, when a centrifugal pump is running like this, what we have seen here, this is what is the called, you know, that volute casing. In volute casing, what is happening? The velocity energy is being converted to pressure energy. So, when the pressure keeps on increasing, what effect did you have on the spindle? Now, the spindle is like this. Now, the spindle is rotating. But the pressure is going to be maximum here. Isn't it? Here it is less. Slowly it is increasing. So when the pressure is more, what impact it will see? If your pump is a normal smaller pump, probably it may not have any effect. Otherwise, if the pump is like your ballast pump or cargo oil pumps of about say 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 cubic meter per hour, then what effect it will have? Now this pressure will have an effect on the spindle like this. So what you can do? You can have another volute, like a casting. The effect of double volute casing. Now this is single volute, this is a double volute. See this? So by having a double volute, now the force is acting on the shaft. Now you have to some extent equalized. So this is the radial thrust, this is the flow rate. Now if it is a single volute, it is going to be like this, and in a double volute, it is going to be mostly like this. So for the rated flow, design rated flow, you see the radial thrust by having a double volute casing, it has reduced. Now this is an advantage. This is what is called double volute casing for centrifugal pumps. Generally, you will find this is used for higher capacity pumps. You may not see for your fire pump or GS pump and all that, but maybe higher capacity pumps like your COPs in the tankers, or maybe your ballast pumps, ballast pump, higher capacity, you know, in bigger ships. It is, we are just looking at the radial thrust. Now see, now the shaft is ready, your impeller is mounted on the shaft. So there is a tendency to bend the shaft, you can say. So that is reduced, that's all.
Nothing happen on the head and all?
No.
Frictional loss?
No. It doesn't have any other effect. But it is, you know, as I have told you, normal in centrifugal pumps, you know, it's not a big issue because the capacity is not that big. But when you are looking at, I told you, you know, like BLCC, say 4,000 or 5,000 cubic meters. So that type of pumps, when you look at the capacity, then this effect of the radial thrust is going to be more. So on the whole, when you see for the rated flow of the ship, you know, you see with a double volute and a single volute, what is happening now? You have an advantage. The radial thrust is reduced with double volute case. And you can just single volute and double volute, you will be able to see this. So, gentlemen, anything else? Reference centrifugal pump? Any other doubts? Any questions?
Single volute casing,
you see at this flow rate it is little high, then it depends upon the design of your, what you call, impeller and the casing, you know, each pump manufacturer slight variations will be there, but then it is coming like this. This is how they do. This is mainly shown for your, you know, in tankers, oil tankers, many ships you will find, you know, very popular. So this guy, I mean this particular company, you see Shinko pumps. You see the capacity, what we are talking about, pump model. What is the capacity here? 5,500 to 6,000 cubics. Total head about 150 meters and the RPM, you see. Say about this much only RPM. Say about 1,200, less than 1,200. See here, all these range. So when it is 3,500 and less, you see 1,500, 400, there it is 1,750, 1,800 RPM and the shaft power. Okay, with reference to in tankers, sometimes we have what we call backstrip system. Any of you had it? Can you explain what is backstrip system? Who had it? I heard some yes.
Devin.
What is backstrip system? How does the system work? Vacuum stripping. It is basically backstrip means what? Vacuum stripping. So how does it work? No, I'm not able to hear you.
Ejector.
See, backstrip system nowadays in many oil tankers you will find, because on the your cargo oil pump, you know, on the inlet side, on the suction pipe which leads to the pump, you will find there is a separating tank. Now the separating tank, because see, the idea here is, as we have seen earlier, the pump has to, all the time it has to have some positive suction head or some way of filling up liquid inside the pump casing. So when the initially when the pump starts, not an issue at that time. In fact, this is what people call it, the AUS, automatic unloading system. Even you have it in product tankers also. AUS, auto unloading, automatic unloading system. Generally, they mean it comes, you know, when the tank is full, when the pump is running full capacity, it's not a problem. It doesn't come. But it comes only when you come down to stripping level. Say about a meter of oil in the cargo tank. At that point of time, see on the, I'll just put a diagram, just have a look. Auto unloading system. Okay, now this is your auto unloading system. Now see, now this is your cargo pump. And where is the cargo tank? Cargo tank is here. Cargo tank, and what is this? Bell mouth. And this is your suction pipe. With a valve, it goes to, this is your COP, cargo pump. And this is the discharge head. Discharge head goes to the manifold. Okay. Now this is the tank I was talking about. This is, what is it called? Separator or separating tank. So usually what happens, so this will be full. Now on top of the separator, it is connected like this, where you have a set of vacuum pumps. Vacuum pumps driven by motor in the engine room, not in the pump room. That's why they have shown separately, engine room, motor. And you have a bulkhead seal here, and the pumps are running, vacuum pumps. And for the vacuum pump, how does it run? You have a freshwater tank. I think you have it in all the ships, you know. Vacuum pump you have, no? For what do you call it? You have a central priming system in some ships, central priming, or you may have individual priming pumps, because how does this pump run? It is slightly different than centrifugal pump, because pump casing needs to be filled with water, and it runs. It is not exactly, it is like a star wheel, it is rotating. You have a casing, you see, the pump will have something like this. So your pump casing will be something like this, slightly elliptical, and this is your impeller, like this. This impeller rotates, and then you have ports. What ports you have? Suction ports, discharge ports, and the whole thing is filled with water. So when the pump is rotating at a very high speed, what will happen? It inlet sides, you know, so the water is being thrown. See, so it will be something like this on top, and so the water within this is being rotated. So when water goes to the you can say major axis of the ellipse, the water goes like this, like a water piston. When water goes like this, what will happen? What happens at the center? Under pressure. See, this, just imagine an ellipse like this. So, water is made to rotate very fast by this impeller. So, what will happen when the water rotates? When it goes to the major axis of the ellipse, water goes on either side, this side and this side. Water is thrown. At that point of time, at the center, what will happen? There will be under pressure. Now, that is connected to the suction side. So what will happen? It will draw air. Okay, by the time the water comes to, from this side, water comes here. So then what will happen? Water will come like this. So at that time, your exhaust ports will be connected. So whatever air that is drawn inside will be thrown to the discharge side. So continuous evacuation of air will be taking place. This is what you have. Don't you have it in the engine room? We call it priming pump.
Yeah.
Now this particular pump is the same. These are the, can you read what is written there?
Vacuum pump.
A set of vacuum pumps are there. Now this pump is filled with the water, fresh water. Now this is rotating. So what will happen? This will create some under pressure. Now the air from this system, when it is connected, air from here will be sucked in. That at that point there will be under pressure here. So always when you use a wax strip system, what will happen is when the level of liquid goes very low, at that point of time this comes, you can put it auto also, and that is why we call it automatic unloading system. So at that point of time the pump will be running. Now this discharge valve will be throttled, not completely closed, throttled. So the flow is going to be very less, so there will be under pressure here. When there is under pressure here, then the vacuum pump will make it under pressure. So what will happen? The liquid from the tank will be sucked in because of under pressure. Pump is running, but with the throttle valve, I mean delivery valve throttle. So because of under pressure, instead of pump pulling the oil, because of under pressure, the oil will be taken from the tank, and this level will keep on increasing. So you have a level controller. You see this? This level controller. So when the level comes somewhere here, then